Warfighter Nation, Ron here with Warfighter Ranch in Isaiah 6:8. And this message is not from your skinny jeans wearing, half head shaved, blue haired, latte sipping, soft preacher. This message is for me. In December of 2003, I was assigned as the Sergeant of the Guard at Camp Junction City in Ramadi when the transmission crackled over the radio that Saddam Hussein had been captured. I distinctly remember one of my Joes, yeah, I'm talking to you, John Eason, who, as I recall at the time, was fresh off of a week-long stint of being 550 corded to another squad member, something like that. TBI has things a little hazy these days. Yeah, I did that. Old Eason, he started hooping and hollering about how we got to go home now. It's over, he said. This was December of 2003, and we had just arrived there in September. This was my first rodeo, and I told him this would probably take a while to mop up. And yeah, we would probably serve our entire year. We did. And thank God we arrived home in September of 2004. That day, you could hear the cheering from throughout the camp as it was carried over Ramadi. We were all ecstatic, and the wave of relief overcame most of us as one of our country's top objectives had been completed. It was the living incarnation of the battle of good versus evil. One of many evil men from throughout history, this time it was a true victory. Not just for us, but for the kingdom of God. Iraq, believe it or not, is deeply rooted in biblical significance. Many key events occurred there, and this was but another. That presumably half of our nation, according to its political leaders, believed that the social media giant Twitter's ban on sitting U.S. president was straight up compared to the takedown of Saddam Hussein. I was in country when that went down, and this was nothing short of a bunch of entitled tech oligarchs shredding a little off the Constitution from behind a keyboard and caving to the mighty dollar, all while bathing in the freedoms that they had no part in securing for themselves, much less anybody else. As you might imagine, the knots in my stomach began double-tying in overtime. Even as I wrote this message, the inner struggle of a teaching point versus anger, well, I find that I am just as frustrated as many of you are. America, the warfighter nation, does not serve politicians. We serve at the pleasure of the Constitution. And make no mistake, this message has nothing to do with the election, how it was conducted, or even any of the subsequent activities in our nation's capital, which unfortunately saw five fatalities. American fatalities. Warfighter Nation fatalities. Unnecessary casualties all. But that's another message. What this is about is the mainstream media's and political left's double standard of constantly appropriating warfighter culture. Actually, I can't tell anymore if it's cultural appropriation or stolen valor. That's a slippery slope, I know. But these loose-lipped politicians don't seem to understand that if you continually demonize those who give you the freedoms you enjoy, well, God is watching. And so is the warfighter nation. And while I'm as frustrated as many of you are, seemingly to a boiling point, I remember that we have to pray. And for those of you who are scoffing right now, somehow thinking, what's in the power of prayer? Well, I would suggest that you're probably not doing it right. Now, granted, there's no perfect way to pray in regards to the verbiage. What matters is that you do it with your whole heart. What matters is that we do it believing in its power, and that we will inevitably receive what we're praying for as long as it's in accordance with God's will. What matters is the condition of our hearts. I see friends and family losing their minds over the political affairs of the day. And I'm constantly reminded that we are not in control. God is. I'm talking to you, Senator-elect Warnock. Recently, you spoke out against the veteran community, saying that no man can serve God and the military. Allow me to refresh your memory and those of the public that you so anxiously desire to serve. King David, Joshua, Gideon, the Maccabees, Jephthah, Ahab, Saul, and my 23 million brothers and sisters. But I digress. No amount of volume, nor how technically proficient, or worse yet, politically correct, the rhetoric, mudslinging, or ass-chewing you may feel you're entitled to dish out, none of it will get us 1 meter closer to peace. Only loving our neighbor can do that. If Americans really want to fight the righteous fight and back the righteous cause, I would be remiss if I did not again suggest the power of prayer. Look, I don't know your background or how you were raised or even what belief systems you were exposed to, and I really don't know what your idea of prayer actually is. Here's what it is to me. Prayer is not passive. It's active listening. It's the original wireless connection. It's the mechanism that God gave us to speak to Him and to hear Him in return. Prayer is a force multiplier unlike anything a lot of people have ever witnessed. I realize that one side of the aisle is laughing hysterically at this message right now. And I'm completely okay with that. Because I'd rather stand with God and be judged by the world than stand with the world and be judged by God. I'm Ron Breland, University of Mogadishu, class of 93, and I approve this message. Smoke Jumper 7, out.